Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations State and Local Officials webinar. I'm Irina Faskanis, Vice President of the National Program and Outreach here at CFR. We're delighted to have participants from 43 U.S. states and territories with us. So thank you for taking the time to be here, and this discussion is on the record. As you know, CFR is an independent and nonpartisan membership organization, think tank, and publisher focusing on U.S. foreign policy. Through our State and Local Officials Initiative, we serve as a resource on international issues affecting the priorities and agendas of state and local governments by providing analysis on a wide range of policy topics. And CFR is also the publisher of Foreign Affairs magazine. So today we are pleased to have Lucy Gettman and Rachel Vogelstein with us. We've shared their bios in advance, so I'll just give you a few highlights. Lucy Gettman is Executive Director of Women in Government, an organization of women state legislators that provides leadership opportunities, networking, expert forums, and educational resources for policymakers. She's also an adjunct professional lecturer for the School of Public Affairs at American University. Ms. Gettman previously served as Chief Advocacy Officer for the National School Boards Association, the Federation of 50 State Associations representing 90,000 local school board members. Rachel Vogelstein is a Douglas Dillon Senior Fellow and Director of the Women in Foreign Policy Program at the Council on Foreign Relations. She is also a Professor of Gender and U.S. Foreign Policy at Georgetown Law School. At CFR, Ms. Vogelstein's research is focused on the relationship between women's advancement and prosperity, stability, and security. So welcome, Lucy and Rachel. Thank you very much for being with us today. Our discussion is commemorating the centennial of the passage of the 19th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, which extended voting rights to women. So I thought we could begin with you, Lucy, to talk about the legacy of the 19th Amendment and the importance of women's contributions to civic engagement and how we continue to increase representation for women in government. So over to you.
Thank you, Irina. I applaud CFR's vision in providing this sort of platform for local and state leaders. And I'm honored to take part with you and with Rachel to talk about women's civic participation and the legacy of the 19th Amendment. As you can see, I'm wearing my suffrage sash today to celebrate 100 years since the 19th Amendment was added to the U.S. Constitution. But we're not just celebrating the suffrage centennial this year. This election cycle, we've elected a new and higher record number of women to Congress. We've elected a new and higher record number of women state legislators. And all of this, as I'll allude to later, is founded in local and state political leadership. So again, I'm honored to be here today. And what I would like to do is frame my response to the topic in the form of four takeaways. The first of which is women have always advocated for agency. The second one is obstacles to women's participation in the public sphere were and are considerable. The third takeaway is women challenged these obstacles from the birthplace to the workplace. And finally, the legacy of women's suffrage includes historic progress and opportunities to complete some unfinished business and to achieve parity in public and private life. So number one, women have always advocated for agency, whether it was Phyllis Wheatley's brilliantly subversive poetry during the colonial age, Abigail Adams exhorting her husband to remember the ladies, whether it was the abolition movement, the temperance movement, the suffrage movement, the movement to pass the Voting Rights Act, women have been change agents even when cultural norms did not accept it. Which leads me to takeaway number two, barriers. The barriers and the norms to women's advocacy and agency were considerable. They were legal, economic, political, and social. Critical cultural norms restricted women's participation to the private sphere of home and family, and these barriers were far, far more egregious for women of color. So number three, turning the tables and turning the tide. Stereotyped as weak, indifferent, or incapable, women nevertheless fought for more than a century to pass the 19th Amendment. Think of Sojourner Truth, whose Ain't I a Woman speech shredded the stereotype for women of color. It was local, state, and federal advocates that fought to restore and extend the franchise. The first toehold was in Kentucky in 1838, when a limited number of women were granted the right to vote in school board and education, taxation, and policy-related elections. And of course, culminated in August 26, 1920, with the certification of the 19th Amendment to the US Constitution. It was a monumental achievement that rested on the efforts of millions of women and men. So takeaway number four, the legacy of the suffrage movement. The legacy includes historic progress and some unfinished business. It was not until the Voting Rights Act passed 4.5 decades later that women and men of color could exercise the franchise. And even then, enfranchise was not complete, did not extend to all groups and populations. The movement was neither perfect nor completely inclusive, and we have more work to do. So having said that, we have a record number of women in Congress beginning next year. And we've also elected the first woman and first woman of color to be vice president. This is a game-changing milestone, and it is impossible to overestimate the importance of this event. So I look forward to continuing the progress that we've made, and I have lots of ideas on how we can do that. At its core, however, local and state leadership. While the rules are changing and there are many paths to political leadership, local and state leaders are the bedrock to parity in national leadership. So with that, I'll wrap up my initial remarks, and I very much look forward to our conversation today.
Thank you. Rachel, over to you.
First, Arena, let me thank you so much for convening this discussion. Lucy, it's wonderful to share an opportunity to talk with you, and thank everyone for joining today. Lucy has provided a masterclass in the history of the 19th Amendment and the 100 years since. And now I'm going to pull the lens back a bit to look at the broader issue of women's political participation, not only in the United States, but around the world, so that we can evaluate how the U.S. compares to other nations 100 years since the ratification of the 19th Amendment. So I'll propose to answer three questions today. The first, where do women wield the most political power globally and in what capacities in the US and around the world? Second, why does women's political power matter? And third, what will it take to finally shatter the highest and hardest glass ceiling here in the United States? So to answer those questions, I'm very pleased to share data from CFR's Women's Power Index, which is available online at cfr.org. So let's start with the very first question, how and where do women wield the most power globally? The short answer is in far too few places. So today, 100 years since the ratification of the 19th Amendment, but also importantly, 4 decades since the adoption of the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, CEDAW, and 25 years after the recognition that women's rights are human rights became a rallying cry at the 1995 United Nations 4th World Conference on Women in Beijing, women remain dramatically underrepresented in governments around the world, including our own. So out of 193 countries, only 22 currently have a female head of state or government. Only 14 have at least 50% women in the national cabinet, and only 4 have reached gender parity in their national legislature. So let's unpack that. Where are women currently serving as heads of state? The 22 countries that have reached that milestone and currently have a woman in office: Bolivia, Bangladesh, Barbados, Belgium, Denmark, Estonia, Ethiopia, Finland, Gabon, Georgia, Germany, Greece, Iceland, Nepal, New Zealand, Norway, Serbia, Singapore, Slovakia, Switzerland, Togo, and Trinidad and Tobago. Now, although only 22 out of 193 countries currently have a female head of state, it's important to note that the number of women serving as heads of state has grown significantly in the modern era, and particularly over the last two decades. So since 1946, 64 countries have had a female head of state or government. Now, these countries, from Bangladesh to Liberia to Germany and New Zealand, vary significantly in terms of the overall status of women in society. But even in countries where women face relatively steep political, economic, and social barriers, they've managed to climb the ladder all the way to the top. And there are several nations, including Norway, Senegal, and the Philippines, that have actually had more than one female head of state. So today, almost 100 women have served their countries in that capacity since World War II, some during times of war, such as Margaret Thatcher in the United Kingdom, others through financial crises, such as Johanna Sigurðardóttir of Iceland. The United States, of course, is still not on this list, which I will discuss more in just a bit. Let's move on to cabinet positions. As of earlier this year, only 14 out of 193 countries have at least 50% female representation in the cabinet. Those countries: Albania, Andorra, Austria, Canada, Colombia, Costa Rica, Finland, France, Guinea-Bissau, Nicaragua, Peru, Spain, Rwanda, and Sweden. In 2019, the proportion of women ministers worldwide reached an all-time high of 20%. How does the U.S. compare? Well, under our current administration, there are only 17% female representatives in our current cabinet. The 50% gender parity threshold has never been reached in our country, and it certainly remains to be seen as we watch the incoming administration take positions and nominate new individuals, whether we might hit that 50% threshold in the next year. What I will note is that incoming President-elect Biden was one of many presidential candidates in the 2020 campaign that took a pledge issued by the Leadership Coalition for Women in National Security to reach gender parity in the national cabinet. So we can continue to watch as it unfolds. We've seen some historic nominations already, with the first female Secretary of the Treasury nominated, but we're still counting the numbers. So we'll see if we reach that threshold and join the 14 nations that have already reached gender parity in the cabinet. On to parliamentary representation. Today, there are only 4 countries out of 193 that have reached gender parity in the national legislature. Those are Bolivia, Cuba, Rwanda, and the United Arab Emirates. And in all of those countries, quotas certainly help to explain the results there. And unsurprisingly, the paltry representation of women in parliaments globally is related to the proportion of women who run for legislative office. So there's only one country out of 193 that's had gender parity and the number of registered candidates in their most recent national election, and that's Cuba. Now, importantly, especially for the participants today, I want to highlight the importance of women's representation at the local level as well. We have less data, but we have some. And for countries where data do exist, only 2 out of 193 have at least 50% female representation in local legislatures: Antigua and Barbuda, and Bolivia. So we've aggregated these indicators into a political parity score on our website, and you can log on to CFR.org and compare nations to one another. I'll just quickly read out the top 10 countries and the bottom 10 to give you a sense of who's at the head of the pack and who's really falling behind. The top 10 countries on our political parity score include Costa Rica, Rwanda, Sweden, Finland, Iceland, Nicaragua, Andorra, Norway, South Africa, and France. The bottom 10, PNG, Yemen, Vanuatu, Kiribati, Brunei, Haiti, Iran, Tuvalu, the Solomon Islands, and Qatar. Okay, so now we've answered the question of where women are wielding power around the world. Now let's move on to our next question: why does it matter? Well, in the aggregate, evidence shows that women's leadership promotes bipartisanship, equality, and stability. And when women make up a critical mass of a legislative body, around 25 to 30%, they're more likely to challenge established conventions and policy agendas. And I'll just give a few examples. Common ground. Women are more likely to cross party lines to find common ground. There's a study in the US Senate that found that women senators more frequently worked across the aisle and ultimately passed more legislation than their male counterparts. In recent years, for example, we saw female legislators in the Senate from both parties join together to negotiate the end to a government shutdown. Female legislators are also more likely to advocate for policies that support health and education, particularly important in the moment that we're living in. Parliaments with a higher share of women lawmakers are also more likely to pass and implement legislation that advances equality, including laws on domestic violence, rape, and sexual harassment. Stability is another important priority when it comes to analyzing the importance of women's leadership. Women's inclusion has been found to make a difference in this area. There's one study that found that when women's parliamentary representation increases by 5%, a country is almost five times less likely to respond to an international crisis with violence. And within countries, women's parliamentary representation is associated with a decreased risk of civil war and lower levels of state-perpetrated human rights abuses like disappearances or killings, political imprisonment, torture, and the like. And then finally, democratic governance. For democratic countries, if you truly believe in democratic governance, then you must be committed to the participation of women, because democracy without the participation of women is nothing less than a contradiction in terms. So that brings us to our final question. What will it take for the US to finally elect a female head of state, as so many other countries have done? Well, according to our Women's Power Index, the US ranks 125th out of 193 countries on our political parity score. And I should be quick to add that these numbers reflect our current Congress and our current administration. We will be updating our index in the new year. But currently in the US, not only do we have only 17% women in the cabinet, as mentioned, we also have only 24% women in Congress, which is actually a record high. As we've discussed, we've never elected a female head of state, and we do not have gender disaggregated data on congressional candidates or in many places for local government bodies. By way of comparison globally, the US currently ranks lower on our index than Iraq, Jordan, Lithuania, Venezuela, and the United Arab Emirates. And out of 35 countries in the Americas, the United States ranks 28th. So these are dismal numbers, but I'm very glass half full, as is my colleague Lucy, on the progress that not only we've seen in recent years, but I expect we will continue to see in years to come. In part, that's reflective of a global trend. In recent years, there's been a rising tide of women's activism that has swept around the world. Online and in the streets, we've seen millions of women raising their voices and calling for action against systemic abuse, harassment, discrimination. And this activism has translated to the ballot box with higher numbers of women running for office than ever before. And the result has been more women in power. So on average, women's global parliamentary representation has dramatically improved from a global average of only 11% in 1995 to the 24% that we see today. And as we've already discussed, the number of women being elected heads of state or government has also surged over the last three decades. More than 85% of all female leaders taking office did so after 1990, and more than three quarters of these women rose to power since the 2000s. And our last several election cycles here in the US are very much in line with that trend. So in 2018, we saw a record number of women run for Congress and win. That has actually, many of those barriers have been shattered in this most recent 2020 cycle. And despite Hillary Clinton's loss in the 2016 election, the fact remains that for the first time in our nation's history, the majority of US voters actually did cast their ballot for a woman. And of course, as Lucy already pointed out, in the 2020 election, Kamala Harris has made history becoming the highest ranking woman when she's sworn in our history, 100 years since women received the right to vote. So I remain glass half full. I think the story is one of progress, particularly rapid progress over the last 25 to 30 years. But as you can hear, there's a lot of work still to do here in the United States at the federal and local legislative level. So with that, I look forward to our discussion.
Wonderful. Thank you both. That was really a wonderful overview, and going into the data is fascinating. So we're going to go to all of you now. If you want to click on the participants icon at the bottom of your screen, you can raise your hand there. If you're on a tablet, you click on the more button on the upper right-hand corner, and you can raise your hand there. So I'm looking for raised hands now. And we'll first go to Representative Pamela Anderson. Please tell us where you're joining us from, and accept the unmute prompt.
Thank you. I'm Pamela Anderson, and I'm a representative in the state of North Dakota. And my question is, I would like to see obviously more women legislators all over the country. Is there any data to say that those that run for statewide office or higher office started as school board or park board or commissioner? Do they start there and move up? Do we know that?
Well, thank you, Representative Anderson. A great friend of women in government, and it's great to share this time with you on this platform. I'll start a response to that question by referring to women's presence in elective office as something of a pyramid, not in terms of the value connotation, but to illustrate the fact that about 40% of locally elected school board members are in fact women. And that's out of 90,000. So that's a lot of women elected officials. But then as we go further and further up the pyramid in terms of other local offices, statewide office, state legislature, and then Congress, that apex becomes narrower and narrower and narrower. So I'd have to look into it a little more deeply to identify specifically whether most state legislators start out as local office holders, but without a doubt, one of the four key pathways to political leadership is advocacy and political engagement. And we certainly recognize that since nearly half of women members of Congress are former state legislators, I mean, we can see that pathway, we can see that ladder of success between the state and federal level. So I'd love to look into that a little more deeply for you, because I really feel that path to power is grounded in local political leadership, and we will reach parity at the national level and at all levels by supporting that.
Thank you. The next question is written from Martha Robertson, who is a legislator in Tompkins County legislature in New York. So for Rachel or Lucy, you probably can answer this too. Does the relative preponderance of women as Democrats versus Republicans confound the notion of which issues they prioritize? And follow up on that is, she says, it remains discouraging that women in top leadership are disproportionately not mothers. Doesn't childcare responsibility still present a barrier? And will the better percentage of elected women help change childcare policies in the US?
I'm happy to jump in. I think there is evidence to suggest that when the percentage of women legislators reaches a critical threshold, that we start to see differences in decision-making. So it was the 30% threshold that I referenced earlier, which makes intuitive sense. If you think of a table, a decision-making table that has, let's say 10 people, one woman, suddenly she is the representative for her entire gender. A lot of pressure, likely to conform, not that likely to see a dramatic departure necessarily in decision-making. Let's imagine now there are two women at the table. They're often compared to one another, and again, may not feel the level of power that it will take to create a different set of priorities. But when you reach that 30% threshold, you do start to see differences, and legislation that relates to equality, education, healthcare, all more likely. So I would certainly put childcare in that category. And we've seen that in countries with some of the most progressive childcare policies in the world, for example, in Scandinavia, that you have, if not gender parity, something very close to it in their legislatures.
Lucy, do you want to?
Sure. I mean, because that was a really great question, because at least at the state level, there is a disproportionate number of R's and D's. Two-thirds of women state legislators are Democrats and one-third are Republicans. Organizations like Women in Government are fully committed to being nonpartisan, not just bipartisan, so that, you know, our board has party parity and we strive for that. And in fact, one strategy we use is to bake that into our best practices by minimizing party identification at our conferences. Our name tags have name and state, but not party. And we find frequently that women are having these conversations and these problem solving sessions with each other without regard to party. So I think there is potential there to sort of get beyond this, get beyond party parity. And I agree wholeheartedly with Rachel that 30% threshold really, really makes a difference. I also want to address the issue of motherhood, because some of you may know that Congresswoman Wasserman Schultz and Rashida Tlaib and 20 or 30 others have created something called the Moms in the House Caucus, because as a result of the 2018 election cycle, there are a record number of women members of Congress who are also mothers of school-aged children. And so they get together to have the very conversation that was brought up in the question about what is it going to take to make it possible for mothers to achieve their political leadership goals. And so we're starting to see an infrastructure around that. And there could also be systemic changes around that in terms of paying for childcare or other systemic opportunities to let that happen.
And as we've seen with the this pandemic, there have been a lot of stories reporting on how many women have had to step out of the workforce to deal with the challenges of home remote learning, online learning for their children. Are you seeing that effect on your data, Rachel, or is that the next iteration of the study to see how COVID-19, what the effect of that will be?
That's a terrific question, Arena. And our data set is reflective of the election preceding this most recent one here and in other countries around the world. So we have not yet factored in, for the most part, the effects of the pandemic on women's ability to run for, compete for, and win office at every level. That said, there are some researchers with whom we work closely who have been tracking this in real time, and we expect our next iteration to reflect the impact. But I would refer you to a recent study that was just put out by my colleagues at the National Democratic Institute that looks at the many ways in which women who have, as you've already identified, disproportionately shouldered the burden of caregiving that has dramatically increased during this pandemic and importantly the shutdowns. That has had not only an effect on women's economic participation, as we've seen an exodus of women from the formal labor force, but we've also seen, at least in this preliminary study, an effect on women's ability to participate politically. And that has tremendous ramifications. I mean, the ability of women to use their time to be involved in public life. You know, if we think it's important to have balanced representation, if that's a fundamental tenet of democracy, is that everyone can participate, we need to think constructively about how to address barriers that stand in the way of women being able to compete for and run for office on an equal basis with men. And so I'll note that there are some bills that have been introduced to, for example, provide resources for childcare to candidates. And that would have a pronounced effect on female candidates, given that women disproportionately have the burden of childcare. You know, that's just one example of a kind of public policy solution to address the disproportionate time burden that women face in terms of household responsibilities and, importantly, caregiving.
Great. Martha Robertson has written something in the chat and also raised her hand. So, Martha, I want to just let you raise what you want.
Thanks very much. This is a fascinating topic, of course. In the chat, I mentioned that, you know, when women wait until their kids are older to get started on political careers, there's still certainly an age-related ceiling. I was first elected when I was 50. That's kind of late to get started. So I think that this is really critical, really important. I think it also sort of begs the question, though, that women can't do it alone. Men have to understand the value and fully support the notion that women are legitimate leaders and have a lot to offer. Are we seeing any kind of changes in the acceptance of female candidates, for example? And we heard a lot about that in this campaign. It's going to continue to be an issue. What are your perspectives?
Well, I certainly think the election of a woman vice president who has a very, very, very supportive spouse will have tremendous value in terms of role modeling and trend setting, because I agree entirely. It's a very important issue. Think of Speaker Nancy Pelosi, who didn't run for office until she was 41. And of course, she was very politically active before that time, but she was also taking time to raise her family. And that does limit the amount of time that you can, you know, achieve seniority and move your way up the ladder and, and ultimately, you know, get to the Oval Office. So I think that making sure that you have family or spousal or other support around you, I mean, those are key and critical decisions. And it also relates to, you know, supporting younger women getting their toehold in political leadership opportunities before even they might even marry or have children. We need to eliminate the barriers in, you know, for fundraising, for, you know, for everything that goes into becoming a political leader. We need to eliminate those barriers at all levels. And the earlier we can start, the better.
I would just add that, you know, from the evidence that I've seen, women running for legislative office, whether it's federal or local, are as likely as men to win. So it becomes a question less of shifting perception and more of addressing the constellation of barriers that affect whether women are able to run in the first instance. And so I would point not only to personal solutions like having a supportive partner, but more importantly, in my view, public policy solutions like ensuring that there's comprehensive childcare system, ensuring that there's paid family medical leave, making sure that we close the income gap between men and women, whether that means addressing pay inequity or looking at the differential in terms of investment in female versus male-led businesses. There's a whole constellation of policies that affect whether women are able to negotiate the about the many demands on their time and the unequal distribution of labor that we see when it comes to caregiving. In my view, if we had a patchwork of policies like that in place, then we would be seeing more women running. So I believe that there's a public policy solution to the challenge that you've raised.
Fantastic. Let's go next to Councillor Lori Dechter Wright.
Thank you so much, and thanks for this thoughtful conversation. I'm on the city council in Tulsa, Oklahoma. In 2018, for the first time in the history of our city, we had a 2-to-1 majority of women on the council. And I think our citizens have really seen the difference in our leadership style and our collaborative style. We also enjoy nonpartisanship, which I think is a huge factor for why we might see on school boards and closer local governments more women, because I think partisanship still really breaks down along gender lines in a lot of ways. And my question in the chat box was, how much does campaign finance factor into success, not just for becoming a candidate, but becoming an elected? I've ran 3 times since 2016. The first time was a partisan race at the state level, and the last 2 times have been this nonpartisan council seat. And I've been outspent 5-to-1, 3-to-1 every time. So I know women can win. And I know a lot of the grassroots volunteer participation I had was almost nearly 100% women. But when it comes to raising those dollars, there's still a huge barrier.
I really agree that that is a significant barrier, particularly in our system, since we don't have a campaign financing system, which means that the dramatic disparity between men and women in our society in terms of access to resources is reproduced in the ability to either self-fund or to have access to a network of donors. And those disparities that you experienced in your own races are, you know, reflected at every level all across the country. You know, one answer to that is certainly a campaign finance reform approach. Another is to address the many reasons why women have less access to capital, whether we're talking about that from a personal perspective or from a professional perspective as compared to men. And so there are a whole suite of policies that would relate to closing those gaps. But I would also note that we've seen efforts that have been tremendously successful in bolstering women's political participation when there are dedicated resources put aside for that precise purpose. In our own country, the organization Emily's List, which I'm sure many of you are aware of, which supports pro-choice Democratic women candidates, that acronym actually stands for Early Money is Like Yeast. The notion was because it makes the dough rise, that investing in those female candidates from a resource perspective would allow them to then go on to raise from other donors and then compete successfully and win. And that certainly has been true when we see the numbers that Lucy talked about in terms of the increases over the last 3 decades in particular of women's political representation here. And there are other countries that have seen dedicated efforts to ensure women's ability to compete on a level playing field in that way. But I would like to also see public policies put into place to close those resource gaps.
Yeah, that is certainly a key issue. And what I'm encouraged by is that fundraising, it has become an integral part of campaign training for potential women leaders at all levels, at the college level, and of course, at the adult level. Another option I'm also intrigued by is recognizing that developing expertise and access to and comfort with fundraising is kind of a continuum. And so I would encourage women who are interested in political leadership to volunteer to be part of that fundraising process, because it gets you in the room with people who have money to give, and you start to become comfortable with those levers, those mechanisms for generating resources. So I think, though, in addition to just training women candidates and emerging political leaders to be fundraisers. It also, you know, help other women by becoming a fundraiser. And I'm sure many of us on this platform maybe are familiar with Nancy Boxker, who just does, that's what she does. She trains political candidates, especially women, to become comfortable with the fundraising process and setting up a finance committee and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I wholeheartedly agree that systemic changes are necessary and desirable. And there's ways to operationalize that both from a campaign staffer or a volunteer standpoint, as well as a candidate.
Thank you. We have a written comment or question from Commissioner Gail Patterson-Gladney, who serves on the Van Buren County Board of Commissioners in Michigan, asking, are there any groups that will help African-American women achieve success in public life? And as a secondary part to in a group questions here, because we have a lot, Afras Khan, who's a city councilor in Newburyport, Massachusetts, asking about educational reform that would integrate aspects of women as leaders or involved throughout policymaking process as part of our public education curriculum development nationwide. Are there any efforts by groups right now trying to add to textbooks and update with a new lens to inspire young women into these critical leadership roles?
Well, I'll start by saying I'm a big fan of the organization Higher Heights, because their raison d'etre is increasing political leadership opportunities for women of color. And they've generated some pretty good data, including the fact that women of color are 7.6% of the population, but currently only hold 5% of state legislative and statewide office political leadership options. So they have the data and they have the programming behind them to create opportunities for women of color. And the only other example I'll mention, although there are certainly many, is the Center for American Women in Politics has they do a lot of great things in terms of training, but they have an initiative called Teach a Girl to Lead, and they disseminate books for young girls like Grace for President, to sort of instill that that process and develop that comfort level, that expectation, and to normalize political leadership for girls at a very young age. So it's not exactly a curriculum change per the question, but there are initiatives out there to integrate women's political leadership opportunities into the educational system.
I'll just add that from a global perspective, there are also some organizations in other countries that are focused on not only increasing the political representation of women in those countries, but specifically focused on increasing the number of women of color or number of women who are part of marginalized or underrepresented groups. So one example that I happen to be writing about right now is focused on Black women in Brazil. And there's a politician who inspired many women in that nation named Marielle Franco, who tragically was assassinated because of her political beliefs. And yet in her wake, there are now organizations and importantly funds dedicated to making sure there are quote unquote a million Marielles and lots of an army of Black women legislators to kind of follow through the path that she blazed there. So there are many examples, I think, not only in this country, but other countries around the world focused on that critical issue. In terms of curriculum and reform, that's an issue near and dear to my heart. In my spare time, I serve on the board of the National Women's History Museum, which aims to build the first ever Women's History Museum in our nation's capital in Washington, D.C. And we are committed to doing that. But one of our other initiatives is focused while we are pushing for a physical building and structure to also work in a virtual capacity. And our website, womenshistory.org, is a terrific place to go where we have online resources. But importantly, we're looking to work with educational communities to reform curricula, given the studies that we've done that show that fewer than 20% of people mentioned in history textbooks are female. And so, you know, the underrepresentation of women that we see around us is reflected by our failure to tell the full story of women's contributions to history in our own country. So I think that's an incredibly important issue. And I'd like to see not only a museum in Washington, but I'd like to see reform around the nation in terms of what we teach our children.
Thank you. Let's go next to State Representative Marie Woodson.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for such a great conversation and really a great platform in order for us to share as women. I have been, I was in a very competitive race as a first-time candidate who has worked for county government. And very, very competitive race, new candidate. And but because I've worked in several campaigns and also I was in county government, I was able to strategize with a team of, a small team of volunteers and was able to be successful with running the race. My issue is while running, I realized, you know, how powerful as well that women are. When we put our mind into something, we can make miracles, because I'm telling you, it was a miracle that I was able to beat this and win the race. And I want to see a lot more women in office. We're seeing the percentage of women in office, and we know we can, I wouldn't say take over, but we can really have more seats at the table, because that's what we really need. How do we begin to get women to strategize better in order for us to really not only get more seats at the table, but to create our own seats also, in order for us to really be successful as women? Because when women are successful and women prosper, the entire family benefits, everybody benefits. And we're not looking at superficial benefits, we're looking at collective benefit for the good of our society, of our nation. So how do we strategize better in order to get more seats?
That's a terrific question. And you know, I think there's a personal response, what we can do individually as people, and then there's a policy response. You know, from a personal perspective, you all, many of you have taken that step that is often recommended, which is run for office yourself. But part of that is not only being willing to take that step, but also other people expressing their confidence in your ability to compete for and win office. So, you know, there's a campaign that I know of that's entirely focused on finding talented women in your life and encouraging them to run. There's plenty of evidence to suggest that men are more likely to seek higher positions, whether it's political office or within the private sector. They're more likely to seek higher positions with fewer qualifications as compared to women. So having a network of folks encouraging women to run for office, I think that's something all of us can do, not only run ourselves, but encourage those around us to run. Then there's a policy response. You know, I will say that as someone who's looked at this issue globally, that quotas have had a tremendous effect on women's political representation around the world. In the rankings that I shared with you earlier, almost all of the countries that have risen to the top, not all, but many have some type of quota system in place. And I am well aware that quotas tend to be anathema in the United States. But even within our own culture, I think that thinking about ways that we can think of targets within, for example, political parties to ensure that we are seeking to whichever party is at issue, that each party seeks to proffer candidates that have a balance that reflects the population. Certainly gender parity, but also thinking about other populations that are underrepresented and marginalized groups that are underrepresented as well. You know, that notion that we should proffer candidate lists and support each party, sometimes more than two parties, every party support a representative sample of candidates, you know, there's a lot we could see parties do internally, I think, to reform their own processes in terms of how they spend money, resources, training, and that would also have a profound effect.
Thank you. Lucy, you want to add anything?
Sure. Yes. There were actually two things that came to mind. One is sort of from a systemic standpoint, I really feel like the rules are changing and that that could benefit women. For example, think of the 2018 cycle with Congresswoman Ilhan Omar, or even the 2016 election of Donald Trump. I think both of those are very colorful examples of how the rules are kind of changing in terms of, you know, more flexibility in the pathways to political leadership. Another thing we haven't talked about too much this morning is that, you know, the value and the option of appointed political leadership positions, because that can often be a strategic step to becoming, you know, visible and active in the public sphere and then throwing your hat in the ring for an elective office. And then finally, one thing that I reflect on is that the leadership skills that political leaders demonstrate are not that different from the leadership skills we see in the private sector in terms of women in corporate leadership or business leadership. And I think an appreciation of the transferability of those kinds of leadership capabilities and strategic thinking has a lot of potential for us moving forward.
Thank you. I'm going to go next to Deborah Lucero.
Yes, thank you. I am a supervisor in Butte County, California, in northern Sacramento area. And my question is really about once you are in office, what I have noticed is that although there are harassment trainings that you are required to take for staff, none of this applies to the elected official. So if you are publicly harassed or harassed as a woman in office, there you have little recourse. And I'm just wondering how women across the country are handling this. How, you know, what can we do in terms of policy, or what can we do to make this more about, I guess they always want to make it about politics, but it's really not. It's simple harassment.
Terrific question. And there is a very clear public policy solution. Certainly there are, you know, cultural issues to address as well, but I would point to the reality that we have permitted a situation in which elected officials have effectively exempted themselves from many of our bedrock civil rights laws. So if we think about the federal level, Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which prohibits discrimination on the basis of sex, of which the Supreme Court has found harassment is one manifestation, does not apply to members of Congress. There is no good reason that I can think of that members of Congress should be exempted from Title VII of the Civil Rights Act. There are also, of course, as you all well know, Title VII analogs in each state. And in too many places, we see that these rules that apply across our society to other businesses don't apply in this case. And so there's often a different set of rules, a different set of reporting procedures. And I think this is an important gap that we ought to close. I'll jump in to add that in the armed forces, in our military, Title VII does not apply. And I think, you know, many of the stories that we have seen over the last several decades of an increase of women's participation in the military, many of those stories have made clear the complete failure of an alternative set of procedures to address this scourge of harassment and in many cases, assault against women. So I think there's a very clear public policy solution. And I hope all of you who are able to push for that in an absolutely bipartisan fashion, because this is an issue that affects folks of all political stripes. There's a clear solution here.
I agree. And a couple of years ago, when the Me Too movement was starting to gather steam, Women in Government conducted a survey of women state legislators just to say, what are your state Capitol buildings considering in terms of a response? And in particular, one California woman legislator comes to mind, whose name, of course, escapes me at the moment, but she chaired the subcommittee that was trying to deal internally with this issue. And they had a great set of conversations about it, but fundamentally for her, it boiled down to, organizational culture eats policy for lunch. So it's so hearkening back to, our cultural norms, our political norms, our economic norms, our legal norms, we really need to change the culture, and policy is a big part of that.
Thank you. I'm going to go next to Emily Holmes. If you can unmute yourself. Okay, I don't know. Emily, you're still muted. Okay, now you can go.
I'm so sorry about that. My name is Emily Holmes. I'm a township supervisor in North Strabane Township, Pennsylvania, which is outside of Pittsburgh. So hello from snowy Pennsylvania. My question is, as I sit here with my 5 and 3-year-olds, I was elected last year, and I know all too well about the challenges of running for local office with young children. And I'm really passionate about cultivating the next generation of female leaders, starting with school-age kids. And I haven't been able to find many resources about that. And specifically, I'm looking into after-school programs or something that we can create at the local level that would generate interest from young girls and also provide childcare for parents who need that for the after-school crowd. So if you have any ideas or suggestions on where to start, I would love to hear them.
It's a terrific question. And my 9 and 11-year-olds are sequestered behind the door that you see behind me. So I relate to the challenge you articulated. And I would point to organizations that are focused on girls' leadership and girls' empowerment. I actually don't know of an organization that has the structure that you just so brilliantly suggested, where there's a combination of a leadership program with childcare provision, which is a terrific idea. But there are a number of terrific girls' organizations that are focused on leadership. Girls Inc. is one that comes to mind. From a global perspective, Girl Up, which is part of the UN Foundation, is another. There are several that would be terrific to explore this idea with. And I hope that you can push that forward and that type of a program can come to fruition.
And likewise, I agree. There are some organizations, and again, there may be regional differences, but also look at Girl Scouts. Their claim to fame is that every single woman member of Congress was a Girl Scout at one time or another. Also look at the League of Women Voters. Their local chapters are doing a lot of leadership cultivation work for school-aged children. The YWCA, again, not universally, but look at the YWCA doing leadership training for programs. And then organizations like Women in Government. At our conferences, we operate something called a Future Women in Government program, and we link college-age women with women legislators attending our conference for mentoring for the duration of that conference. And that's not an ongoing after-school program, but there are lots of places to explore for that kind of work.
Thank you. I'm sorry we couldn't get to all the questions. There is one I just wanted to ask from Jane Baez de Sessa, who's the city manager of Brighton in Brighton, Colorado. Is there any data regarding women in local government, especially those who've been elected to offices such as mayor and city council? Are you collecting that data, Lucy, or are there any organizations that are doing so?
Well, my go-to organization is the Center for American Women in Politics at Rutgers University, their Thomas Eagleton Institute, because they do keep data on the number of women mayors and a number of other local leadership, like city managers and that sort of thing. So that the most recent, they have some 2019 and 2020 data on their website. And so the Center for American Women in Politics is a great source of data.
I will just add though that I also use that same institution as my go-to, but this is an area where we see too many data gaps. And mm-hmm. this is true not only in the United States, but in countries around the world. And pre-pandemic, I participated in a UN meeting to try and get countries around the world to commit to collecting data on the gender and racial breakdown of candidates and representatives of local legislators and local office. So I do hope that's a data call that we can make at the local level, but also at the national level and the international level, so that we have a better picture of where women are serving and where they're running in the important local legislative level here in the US and around the world.
Thank you both very much for today's conversation. And there was a very rich discussion in the chat and exchange of ideas. So thanks to all of you for participating and your wonderful comments and questions. We appreciate it. Lucy Gettman and Rachel Vogelstein, I was morphing names, you can follow their work. Lucy's work on Twitter at Women in Gov. It's Women in Gov, G-O-V-T. And you can use their hashtag Connecting Legislative Leaders. And you can follow Rachel's work at CFR_WFP. And if you go to our website, CFR.org, you can go and look at the work that Rachel's doing and the Women's Power Index. We will also be sending out links to the resources that were mentioned on this call, as well as a link to the webinar so you can watch it again or share it with your colleagues who weren't able to join. And again, please let us know how we can be a resource to you. Send us suggestions to stateandlocal@cfr.org. And I hope you all are staying safe and well, and wishing you all happy holidays.